Hello, and welcome to Unity Spiritual Center, Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. My name is Wendy Karr. I'm a licensed Unity teacher, and it is my privilege to fill in for Reverend Ann today. Let us join together in a time of prayer and meditation. As we get ready, I invite you to do three things. First, relax your body a little bit more than it is right now. Second, I invite you to allow my words to be your words and my voice to be your voice for the next while. And finally, I invite you to take a few deep breaths and find the space within yourself where you feel that sense of oneness, where you feel a sense of connection, where you feel that sense of I am. I'd like to start today's meditation with the words of our co-founder, Charles Fillmore. I am now in the presence of pure being and immersed in the Holy Spirit of life, love, and wisdom. I acknowledge thy presence and thy power, O blessed Spirit. In thy divine wisdom, now erase my mortal limitations. And from thy pure substance of love, bring into manifestation my world, according to thy perfect law. And let us take a few moments in quiet. And let us listen to a prayer drafted for a time of pandemic. We know that God is a love that has no end and a power that knows no bounds. God's healing power of divine life is restoring, healing, and revitalizing our world in this very moment. We let go of any fears or anxieties, and we affirm that all are safe, healthy, and protected. We bless all those who support us in maintaining vibrant, radiant health. We express divine life in all we think, say, and do. We bless our global family with radiant health, peace of mind, and abundant love. Let us join together heart to heart, soul to soul, hand to hand, and take these words into our hearts. A prayer for a time of a call for social justice and human rights. As one in divine presence, we embrace our common humanity. We are held in the loving arms of Spirit, and we rise above fear to walk in love, faith, and peace. Our hearts are with all who are touched by current and recent events. We release any beliefs that divide us and turn to one another with understanding. Wisdom reveals the path to healing for our communities. With unity of purpose, we create justice, equality, and peace for all people. In the abundance of God, there is enough. Enough love, enough peace, enough freedom for all to live together as one. We hold this vision of healing and harmony for ourselves, our communities, and our world. May we remain resolute in walking the course of human rights and social justice for all. And let us take this thought into the quiet. And let us come to a time of closure of our meditation with the affirmations from Silent Unity for August 2020. For inner peace, we affirm, with God as my peace, I rest deeply and breathe easily. With God as my peace, I rest deeply and breathe easily. Our affirmation for guidance. I am guided by infinite wisdom in all matters. I am guided by infinite wisdom in all matters. Our affirmation for life. I am one with and now fully flourish in divine life. I am one with and now fully flourish in divine life. Our affirmation for strength. Through wind and storm, I stand steady, knowing God is my strength. Through wind and storm, I stand steady, knowing God is my strength. Our affirmation for harmony. I am willing to be a presence of divine love in all my relationships. I am willing to be a presence of divine love in all my relationships. And let us conclude with an affirmation for all the prayer requests on our hearts, in prayer boxes and ministries throughout the world. knowing that all is well in the truth of God, that we can be the oneness that we seek, and that love, harmony, and wisdom can guide us in all things. Let us join together and send a blessing to the world. And for this time together, for this opportunity to join on the path of oneness, we are so grateful. And so it is. Amen.
Okay, let's start singing Room at the Table. Let our hearts not be hard to those living on the margins. There is room at the table for everyone. This is where it all begins. This is how we gather in. There is room at the table for everyone. Too long we have wandered, burdened and undone. But there is room at the table for everyone. Let us sing the new world. This is how it all begins. There is room at the table for everyone. There is room for a song, and no gift is too small. For everyone, there's enough if we share. Come on, pull up paycheck. There is room at the table for everyone. No matter who you are, no matter where you're from, there is room at the table for everyone. Here and now we can be the beloved community. There is room at the table for everyone. There is room for a song, and no gift is too small. There is room at the table for everyone. There's enough if we share. Come on, pull up paycheck.
Singing back of vocals.
There is room for a song, and no gift is too small. There is room at the table for everyone. There's enough if we share. Come on, pull the page. There is room at the table for everyone. Let our hearts not be hardened to those living on the margins. There is room at the table for everyone. This is where it all begins. This is how we gather in. There is room at the table for everyone. No matter who you are, no matter where you're from, there is room at the table for everyone. Here and now we can be the beloved community. There is room at the table for everyone. For everyone. For everyone.
And now, I am the thinker that thinks the thoughts.
Right. I am the thinker who thinks the thought that changes things that shape my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought. I have the power to change my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought that changes things that shape my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought. I have the power to change my life. If you ask me, who am I? I am wisdom, I am light. I am more than meets the eye. I cannot be defined. I am the thinker who thinks the thought that changes things that shape my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought. I have the power to change my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought
the changes, things that shape my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought. I have the power to change my life. If you ask me, what am I? I am beauty, I am joy. I am more than meets the eye. I cannot be defined. I am the thinker who thinks the thought, the changes, things that shape my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought. I have the power to change my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought, the changes, things that shape my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought. I have the power to change my life. Woo! Are you dancing? I can choose to be the light and brighten someone's darkest night. I'm so much more than meets the eye. I cannot be defined. I am the thinker who thinks the thought, the changes, things that shape my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thoughts. I have the power to change my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought, the changes, things that shape my life. I am the thinker who thinks the thought. I have the power to change my life. I have to change my life. I have the power to change my life.
Thank you, Emilio, and thank you, Brenda. And let us take a moment and just allow the week that has been to be in the past and the week that is coming to be in the future. And just to align ourselves in this moment. And joining together. We are so grateful for technology that allows us to come together across miles, across time zones, across very time and space. We are so grateful for everyone who has worked to bring this service together. And we are so open and receptive to the blessings of today and every day. And for this time to come together, we are so grateful, and so it is. Amen. And now let's join together in There Is Only Love.
When it seems
I've lost my way. I would go inside and quiet my mind, and I'd hear Spirit say, there is only love, there is only love, love that heals, love that sets us free, there is only love, there is that sets us free. There is only, only, there is only love.
Thank you, Emilio. I do love that one. And now it's time for our Daily Word, which is a Unity publication. It's been around for not quite 100 years, guiding us and providing inspiration on a daily basis. Our word for today is compassion, and our affirmation is, I am kind and compassionate. I affirm truth for everyone I hold in prayer. Seeking to grow in compassion, I look to the example of Jesus. Gospel stories give many examples of Jesus showing compassion by demonstrating keen awareness of the needs and feelings of friends and strangers alike. I remember learning that Jesus did not turn away from social outcasts. He healed them and shared meals with them. His compassion fed a multitude and restored wine to a wedding reception. Upon learning that his dear friend had died, Jesus wept. Even when his disciples deserted him as he was crucified, Jesus asked God to forgive them. As I desire to grow in compassion, I know that my kind words and even simply my loving presence provide comfort. I listen deeply with my heart as well as with my ears. And our scripture reading today is from Philippians, the 2nd chapter, 4th verse. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Our theme for this year is perfect vision, seeing through a spiritual lens for 2020. And our theme for August is inclusion in action. I release resistance and experience acceptance. And this week, our theme is, let's get together and feel all right. Okay, I need to dance a little bit. Our Sunday lesson today is pulling from my background as a historian and our development of unity, two individual spiritual journeys, one worldwide spiritual movement. And the graphics you see, the one in the background, is of one of the very first Unity buildings at what was then Unity Farm and is now Unity Village. And the document is the dedication and covenant of our co-founders. And that's our focus for today, how we got to that point. So let me introduce you to one of our co-founders, Myrtle Page Fillmore. She was born on August 6th of 1845 in Ohio. She was one of many children. I think there has finally sorted out how many, but she was in a large family. And the disease called tuberculosis ran in her family. And as a child, she was not well most of the time. And I've read different places where she was basically told, in essence, don't have plans, you're not going to live very long, you're going to have a miserable life. But Myrtle had it in her heart that she wanted to be a teacher, that she wanted to take care of children. And this at that time would have been one of the few professions that she as a single female would have been allowed to have. Indeed, at the time, when she got married, she had to quit her job. And it wasn't up beyond the possibility that the board of trustees of the local school board would have a say in who she could date. So she traveled around, eventually ending up in Clinton, Missouri, and in Denison, Texas. And it was clear from the writings that her health did fluctuate, as can be expected with something like tuberculosis. Certainly being in the South was a lot healthier for her than being up in the northern regions of Ohio. Let me introduce you to her eventual husband, Charles Fillmore. Charles was actually her junior. He was born on the 22nd of August, 1854. He was born outside of St. Cloud, Minnesota. His father was a trapper. His mother was a dressmaker. They divorced when he was about 7 years old, and his younger brother, Norton, actually ran away to live with their dad. So it's kind of an interesting story insofar as we hear about Charles and Norton for a while swapping between his parents' homes, which were about 10 miles apart. Grandma Fillmore, as she was known in the movement, was amazing. Not only was she a dressmaker, but she was described as the kind of woman who could take a handful of beans, some vegetables from the garden, and feed everyone for a week. Charles and Myrtle met at the Literary Society in Texas. And Charles later wrote that when he saw her across the room, he heard a little voice inside him say, "Charles, there is your wife." They were married in 1881 and welcomed their first son, Lowell, in 1882, followed by a second son, Rickert, in 1884. By 1885-86, Myrtle's health was deteriorating. As many women will agree, childbirth is not an easy process now or then. In 1886, having been given a terminal diagnosis of maybe 6 months, Myrtle began to reach out. Her son, Lowell, wrote later that their medicine cabinet was filled with every lotion and potion you can imagine, and that anybody who had a healing remedy was invited to come and demonstrate their wares. But what Myrtle caught onto was a lecture. We don't know much about the lecture. We do know the phrase that she came out with. "I am a child of God, and therefore I do not inherit sickness." Now, for those of us in the 21st century, that might sound very commonplace. We've been talking about the importance of the mind and the body for decades now. But at the time, this was blasphemy, virtually heresy. The idea that, A, you were a child of God, and that therefore there was an inheritance involved, just went contrary to most Christianity at the time. But Myrtle worked with this idea. She sat in times of prayer, and she did two things. First, she apologized to her body. She apologized for holding thoughts that it was weak or unable to take care of itself. And then she affirmed the health and vitality of each cell and organ in her body. By 1889, she was cured. And how we know that is in 1889, she gave birth to her third son. Unhealthy bodies don't give into pregnancy easily. Now, Charles had not been raised with much religious training. Myrtle's family was Methodist and very much so. Charles, on the other hand, he didn't get this religious stuff. It didn't work for him. And indeed, he really wasn't too interested in what Myrtle was up to until he started to see the results. And then he got curious, as Charles was. In another talk, I'll share that some of the things that Charles went through to get to the Unity Movement. But Charles came and started reading. He started reading various traditions, not just Christianity. He was voracious in his reading. And he says, "Either I can go directly to headquarters or the whole thing is a fraud." He couldn't accept the idea that the only way you could talk to God was through a saint or a religious leader, that there had to be a direct, intimate, personal relationship. Now, Charles, being Charles, decided to see if he could prove his wife's experiment by recreating it. So he too started to work on prayer. He had had a number of accidents as a child and really wasn't expected to live, for starters, and certainly wasn't expected to have the kind of life he did. He too started to show and demonstrate that his body could restore itself. He noted that his hearing, which had always been problematic, started to clear up, and his vision started to clear up. And indeed, a leg that had been withered as a result of a skating accident had begun to strengthen and indeed lengthen. So these two are married. They have three small children. They have found something that works, something that isn't traditional Christianity and certainly is not being supported by other churches as being part of Christianity. But they're finding it works. They're finding, like scientists, that they can do things and have not only results, but have other people recreate the results. And thus we start with the Unity Movement in 1889. Charles is so dedicated and so convinced of what he is doing that he actually quits his job in real estate to devote himself full time to spiritual study and writing. I love this picture. Yours fraternally, Charles Fillmore. I put this in because most photos of Charles do not have his beard. He was a bearded man, actually, in his early days. And it was only when he was asked to play an Irish washerwoman in a staff play that he shaved. And Myrtle kind of liked him clean shaven, and so he stayed thus. In 1892, Charles and Myrtle sat down, pulled out a piece of stationery, and wrote their dedication and covenant. I'll go through the wording in a moment, but what I want to do is set the stage for you. Charles and Myrtle knew that they had written this document. I don't know if their sons knew that they had written this document. No one in the Unity Movement knew about this document until 1942, when they were going through Myrtle's papers and they found it. And what was amazing for us as historians and as Unity leaders was to see exactly what Charles and Myrtle were committing to. And as I've gone through to become a licensed Unity teacher, this was one of the things we were invited to do, to write our own personal dedication and covenant. It's very much sounding like a legal document. We, Charles Fillmore and Myrtle Fillmore, husband and wife, hereby dedicate ourselves, our time, our money, all we have and all we expect to have, to the spirit of truth, and through it to the Society of Silent Unity, which was the name for Unity at the time. It being understood and agreed that the said spirit of truth shall render unto us an equivalent for this dedication in peace of mind, health of body, wisdom, understanding, love, life, and an abundant supply of all things necessary to meet every want without making any of these things the object of our existence. In the presence of the conscious mind of Christ, this seventh day of December, AD 1892, and then it is signed by both Charles and Myrtle. Can you hear the languaging in this? They have very clearly made up a legal contract. We will do this, and God will do this. And they kept to this promise. And this is how the Unity Movement was created. And this explains a lot of what they did in the early days of the movement. In the earliest days, it wasn't an intention to set up a new church. That didn't come until the early 1900s. What they wanted to do was provide some tools, an opportunity for people to take whatever religious path they were on and enhance it with some understanding of metaphysical and spiritual principles. And by principles, I mean in the same way that we have physical laws, ideas that there are spiritual principles which are equally applicable to every person across the world and that don't change with time and space. So, in a later picture, let me introduce you to the family. Because all six of these people each played an important role. In the back, from left to right, we have number one son, Lowell, Rickard in the middle, and Royal on the right. And in the front are Myrtle, Charles, and Charles's mother, Mary, otherwise known as Grandma, as I already said. Lowell eventually replaced his father when Charles was ready to step back. Rickert was the brilliant one who created Unity Village, and anyone who's seen pictures or has had the opportunity to attend will attest that the architecture there and the function is quite interesting. Back in the day, the fountains, as they were before the renovation, were actually the air conditioning. And I can tell you from having been down there for studies in the fall, if the fountains had already been drained and we had a heat wave. There was no air conditioning to suffice for us. Royal actually passed early. He was the first of the family to pass. And that's a whole other story. But he too was instrumental. He had the idea of, let's make a place where people can get away from the city. And thus, Unity Farm, which became Unity Village, was developed. Myrtle was key in our prayer ministry. She was the head of the prayer ministry until she decided to retire and give it off to May Rowland. May held the position of Director of Silent Unity for many decades, through not only the First World War, but the Depression, the Second World War, Korea, and into Vietnam. So this has been a very strong part of Unity's movement. Grandma Fillmore, well, she didn't do this religious stuff. But what Grandma Fillmore did was she took care of the kids. She made sure Charles and Myrtle were fed. In fact, when Rickert started building for in earnest at the village, he built a house for his parents that didn't have a kitchen. And that was intentional, because Grandma did the cooking anyway, so why would you need a kitchen? So from the path of these two, and I would say that they had slightly different paths. Myrtle, certainly in her writings, you see her as the heart of Unity. She asked the question, who will take care of the children? And when the answer came back to her in prayer, well, that's your job. She didn't hesitate. She started a magazine called We Wisdom, which published for 100 years. She wrote a couple books for children about Unity principles in a way that children could understand. It was she who kept the heart of Unity going. Charles was very much more the intellectual and logical part of the movement. He got into technology. They had on-site printing presses. They did all of their own book printing. At one point, they even recorded, pressed, and manufactured their own records. He had a radio station, and don't tell the FAA, but he'd boost the signal after midnight when nobody was looking. Why was that significant? Well, if you know anything about curvature of the earth and radio waves, there were people in Africa who were listening to him live. I mean, let that sink in the 20s and 30s. People in Africa were walking miles to whoever had a transistor radio who could pick up that signal. Something this huge could not be kept under a bushel. Charles and Myrtle made it to their 50th wedding anniversary. And in September of 1931, Myrtle went around to her staff and said goodbye. And everyone said, well, why? You look perfectly healthy. And her answer, as reported by many people, was, my dear, the work I need to do, I can do better from the other side. Charles continued the work, and we'll talk about that next week. But what an amazing couple to work through not only their own personal health challenges, but to raise a family. And through their discussions and understandings and their prayer and meditation times, find a movement that has lasted over 100 years and is continuing to bless this world. So my thought for this week, what would your dedication and covenant look like? What parts of it are you willing to commit to? And I know in the past we've had things where we attend a workshop and we commit to something. But I invite you to take that kind of commitment deeper. That kind of commitment that doesn't just involve your time, but your talents and your treasures as well. That involves all of you. And be bold in what you are asking for in return for that service. Perhaps don't limit it to a Ferrari in a 2,400 square foot, apartment, but let's expand ourselves. Let us not be limited by what the world says we can accomplish, but let us see what happens when each of us allows our light to truly shine. I thank you. And now I'll turn it to Emilio with My Religion is Kindness.
Thank you, Wendy.
My religion is kindness. My church is nature. My God is a feeling that lives deep inside. My job is to be conscious. My path is forgiveness. My religion is kindness, and I practice it every day. Everyone has a story. Everyone has pain. When we strip away our mask, we find that we're really all the same. It's those little things that we say and do that can mean so much. It's a smile, a connection, a simple love and touch. My religion is kindness. My church is nature. My God is a feeling that lives deep inside. My job is to be conscious. My path's forgiveness. My religion is kindness, and I practice it every day. Today I'm gonna ask myself, what more can I do to be a radiant child of God and let my love shine through? I'm gonna let my heart be my guide to give the best of me. I'm gonna share my joy, share my love, give it boundlessly. My religion is kindness. My church is nature. My God is a feeling that lives deep inside. My job is to be conscious. My path's forgiveness. My religion is kindness, and I practice it every day. Yeah. Fetch a pail of water. But then Jack fell down and broke his crown. And then Jill came running after. She said, Jack, tell me, what can I do to help ease your mind? He said, hold my hand and just be kind, and I know that I'll be fine. My religion is kindness. My church is nature. My God is a feeling that lives deep inside. My job is to be conscious. My path's forgiveness. My religion is kindness, and I practice it every day. My religion is kindness. My church is a nature. My God is a feeling that lives deep inside. My job is to be conscious. My path's forgiveness. My religion is kindness, and I practice it every day. My religion is kindness, and I practice it every day. My religion is kindness, and I'm gonna practice it every day.
We are so blessed with Emilio's giving of his time, talents, and treasure. Awesome, awesome. I love working with Emilio. And now it's time to come to our place of prosperity. And this can be a challenging section. But I want to invite you to imagine yourself as holding a basket. And as fast as you can pull stuff out of the basket to share with others, it is being refilled even more quickly. And we acknowledge that in worldly eyes, it can feel difficult. But let us acknowledge that in the greater vision, in the part of us that is divine, in the part of us that is one with God, we are unlimited. As Charles and Myrtle said in their dedication and covenant, they affirmed that they would receive everything they needed, and they did. And this is our opportunity to recreate that understanding in our own lives. And let us join together in our affirmation. From the love of all pure spirit in me, I bless all that I give. It goes forth to heal and bless and prosper. It is evidence of my faith in the good in my life. It does great work in the world, and it returns to me multiplied abundantly. I am prosperous. And now, as we continue to think on our prosperity, Emilio is going to bless us with one power.
This is it all. One power, one power, one power. There's one power invisible, and you see it everywhere and every day. One power indescribable, and you speak of it with every word you say. Mysterious until you know the truth, as simple as the love inside of you. Call it God, call it Spirit, call it Jesus, call it Lord, call it Buddha, Baha'u'llah, angels, wings, or heaven's door. But whatever name you give it, it's all one power. Can't you see? It's the power of the love in you and me. One power, oh, one power, one power. We speak so many languages, have different clothing, different colors, different names. But different is only dangerous when we forget that in our hearts we're all the same. And we'll remember when we close our eyes to see that such distances were never meant to be. Call it God, call it Spirit, call it Jesus, call it Lord, call it Buddha, Baha'u'llah, Hashem, or heaven's door. It's Muhammad, it's your mind, it's your soul, or it's your sign. It's the universe, it's music, Mother Earth or Father Time. But whatever name you give it, it's all one power. Can't you see? Whatever name you give it, it's the very air we breathe. It's the power of the love in you and me. One power. Oh, one power, one power. One power, one power, one power. It's the moment of creation, it's an everlasting peace, it's the freedom of forgiveness, it's the sweetness of release, it's the joy of inspiration, it's the sunshine on your face, it's the birthright of all nations. It's the boundlessness of space. It's the beauty of a baby, the serenity of sleep. It's the anger we abandon for its love that's most deep. It's one power. Lives forever in you and me. It's the power of the love in you and me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I always love that one. And as we bring our time of service to a close, let us just take a moment. Allow the music to flow through us. And let us join together in our closing prayer. The infinite mind of God fills my consciousness with all I need to live a full and happy life. I follow the guidance. I am peaceful. I release all fear. I am living love. And so it is. And we'll conclude with Life is for Living.
This is from the hymnal Wings of Song. Life is for living. Whatever you will live for, you will give. Life is for giving. Whatever you will give to life will live. Life is for doing. For living, giving, doing, learning how. Life is for you. And life is for me. Life is for living now. Life is for loving. Whatever you will love enough is yours. Life is for sharing. Whatever you will share with others grows. Life is for being, for loving, sharing, being, learning how. Life is for you, and life is for me. Life is for living now. Life is for living now. Woo!
Have a great week. Thank you for joining us.